गुड मॉर्निंग फ्रेंड्स, आई एम डॉक्टर योगेश सरोदे ऑफ जीवन विकास महाविद्यालय देवग्राम. आई हार्टली वेलकम यू ऑल इन दिस लेक्चर. फ्रेंड्स, इन द लास्ट लेक्चर वी हैड सीन द इंट्रोडक्शन ऑफ द लेसन एंड अबाउट द ऑथर ऑफ द लेसन बिटवीन द मॉस्क एंड द टेम्पल. एंड इन दिस वीडियो we will focus on comprehension part of the lesson by reading. So be attentive. Banu was awakened every morning by the crowing kukreku sound of the rooster. She was out of her four-poster bed almost as soon as she was awake. The dabri pimmi was already sweeping the floors, and when Banu got out of bed, Pimmi folded the blankets and raised the mosquito net. As she got older, Banu replied increasingly on Pimmi, not only for household chorus but companionship. The sun would be rising as Banu said her kushti prayers, and the other morning birds, quails, sparrows, bulbuls, announced their presence. One morning she said an extra yatha ahu vairo prayer because she was anxious about the outcome of the day. As chairman of the sanitation committee, Banu had to settle a dispute between a Hindu and a Muslim faction about the placement of a rubbish bin. The Hindus said it was too close to their temple and wanted to move it farther away, but the Muslims said it was already too close to their mosque and wanted to move it closer to the temple. The collector, who was responsible for the collection of revenue in the surrounding wadis, had warned that a bloodbath might ensue if she were not careful. It was not safe for a man, let alone a woman, but Banu had said she was the chairman and set a day to examine the site. After saying the extra prayer, Banu put on a plain cotton blouse, a plain sari with a plain border, and plain black walking shoes with plain brass buckles to look more businesslike. She never wore bangles and rings and tilas, so she didn't even have to think about that. She breakfasted on one egg, one slice of bread, a coffee which she slurped from the saucer because it was too hot, while listening to the news on her Murphy radio. The collector sent a car to pick her up, but she sent it back. She had chosen to walk because it wasn't far and she wanted to show the people she was also just like them. But she was glad to the two committee members who had come with car stayed with her. They would have been little help in a riot, but she was glad for their moral support. The day became hotter as she set out, and she held up the sash of her sari to shield her eyes from the sun. Along the way, a group of students recognized her and said, "Saibji, Banubai, tame kem chao? How are you today?" Banu stopped. "Sari Kani, I'm well, but we have got important work to do. We cannot wait around for chit-chat." "Where are you going, Banu Bhai?" Banu smiled suddenly. There were Hindus and Muslims among the students. An idea struck her. She remembered Gandhi's salt march, during which Hindus and Muslims of both genders and all castes and ages had united in a show of solidarity against the English. "Come, come, see for yourself." "No, we are not going far. Everybody come." The students followed her, and as they walked, more people joined them. Six women with baskets of vegetables on their heads on their way to Mota Bazar, two men carrying a crate of tiffins between them on their heads on their way to college, chanawalas doing business. As they walked, a other hawkers, begging children, street animals, an acrobat. "Come, come," the student said, as if they were on a picnic. "Come, see what is going to happen." Soon the collector's car approached them again, and the collector himself got out. "Why, you didn't want the car, Banubhai? It would have been better, do you not think?" Banu called him with her hand. "Come with us. See for yourself." The collector understood. The retinue Banu was building for herself was more impressive than Rolls Royce. The populist was always more effective than the aristocratic approach. He took his place by her side. Banu led the parade, the men mostly in white, the women more gaily dressed, with dogs and goats and chickens along the dusty wadis. The dirty paths, the cobbled streets, past the tiny huddled shops of the cobblers, tailors, potters and other artisans, around phlegmatic cows swishing tails at flies, past pyramids of dry dung, amid a constant ringing of bicycle bells and honking of scooter hooters. When a white cow stood in their path, Banu genuflected and others did the same. She was enjoying herself. She wouldn't hear somersaulted. She was sure others would follow suit. When they got to the rubbish bin, the Hindu and Muslim spokesmen and their followers started with their mouths open, not just at the crowd, but because the chairman was a woman. The Hindu, a fat man with a red handkerchief knotted at its four corners on his head, a kurta, a dhoti and chappals, said, Maiji, you are the chairman. Maiji, you are the chairman. Yes, Banu said. Why are you so surprised? Nothing, but you are the chairman. The Musalman was much darker, wearing a red fez with a black tassel, a brown jacket buttoned to his neck even in the heat, and brown tailored pants which revealed red socks at his ankles, overworn, dusty brown shoes. He said nothing, but his brow was wrinkled in puzzlement so that his eyebrows became one long ridge. Banu got straight to the point. "The solution is simple," she said. But we have to go to be reasonable. We have got to find the place exactly between the mosque and the temple. I want you both to walk with me from the mosque to the temple and count my footsteps." Banu spoke with such assurance that passerby might have thought she would have rehearsed the event. The Musalman walked grudgingly, stiffly, a little to the side, as if he were not with them, his brow still wrinkled, as if he were thinking important thoughts counting in his mind. The Hindu walked with Banu, counting loudly in a sing-song voice, as if he were learning numbers in school. The crowd counted along just to add thunder to the proceedings. They counted exactly 232 steps to the temple. Banu turned to the enthusiastic crowd. "Now, what is one up of the 232? A number of cheerful voice replied, 116, my G. 116. She asked them to count with her again as she walked back to the mosque and stopped at 116. "This is the middle point," she said. "This is where you must put the beam." It meant moving the beam closer to the temple and farther from the mosque. Banu was relieved because she felt the Hindu would give in more easily than the Musalman. "This is the best place," she said. "This is the fair place. What do you think?" She looked squarely at the Hindu. The Hindu looked at his followers, who nodded. He beamed. "It's fair, my G, it's fair." The Musalman did not smile, said nothing, but nodded his approval without even looking at his faction. Both thanked her and said it was a wise decision. they were indebted to her. If she needed them for anything, they would definitely come. Anyone could have provided the solution, Banu said later. But it helped that so many came with me, also that I was a Parsi and not a Hindu or a Musliman. And it helped even more that I was a woman, that just surprised them too much to argue. And here in this lesson. So friends, from the above reading, it seems clear that there is mismatch of the two groups, Hindus and Muslims. Banu acts as an intermediate between these two parties and find out solution by counting steps exactly at 116, where she puts the dustbin and the matter here settles. So definitely you might have understood this lesson. In the next part, we will see analysis of this. Till then, good day. Thank you.